Now, in this video, we're going to show that James Butts deliberately violated the law in his campaign to be reelected. But for those that don't believe that anybody that was a mayor already would ever take the chance of breaking the law just for a job, for those people, we offer you these facts. First, about a year into his first term, even though it was fervently opposed by two other council members, James Butts spearheaded the end to Inglewood's first public access channel, turning it into a governmental access channel. For 30 years, Inglewood residents were allowed to produce plays or music shows or even political talk shows, but Butts led two other members of the council to end the public's access and force all the channel's content to be controlled only by the city council. And this was done even though the city admitted that only one other South Bay city had any limitations on free speech on their cable channels. And that city's policy was not as limiting as the one Butts and his allies proposed. In fact, the new policy completely barred any political free speech whatsoever. Next, less than a year later, right before an election where Butts was trying to get two new councilmen elected, Butts voted to move half of the city council meetings to the early afternoon, making it harder for working people to attend meetings and limiting public criticism against him. However, not surprisingly, over the next 10 months, only about 13 out of 35 meetings were actually held at night, with some daytime meetings at times being almost empty. Next, coincidentally, only about 6 weeks before the election, James Butts cut the time for the last public comments at city council meetings from 3 minutes to only 1 minute, cutting the public's criticism of him by about 66%. Then, about 3 weeks later, and only about 3 weeks before Butts' election day, the city coincidentally stopped publishing new YouTube videos of the council meetings, keeping the public from hearing evidence about James Butts' scandalous personal life. Then, only about a week before the election, coincidentally, all the videos of the last 3 years of city council meetings, where residents could easily see James Butts using lies, intimidation, violations of meeting rules, and violations of the law and civil rights to manipulate and lie to residents. 3 years of meeting videos were suddenly and without warning made private and inaccessible to the public. 2012, 2013, and 2014 all made private. Just a week before the elections, all the video evidence of James Butts' dishonesty and law-breaking had now been made inaccessible to the public. So we've seen what James Butts did in his unofficial campaign for re-election, but in his official campaign, his conduct wasn't much better. Even though he cut the public's time to speak, he regularly took more time than the rules allow for him to brag or defend himself against his critics. He had paid for gigantic billboards, paid for robocalls, and paid for almost daily campaign flyers to go to voters' homes, and he had paid for hundreds of campaign signs to be put on supporters' private property. But even though not one of the other three candidates in the race had any signs, any billboards, or any robocalls with their name, all that overwhelming legal advertising still wasn't enough for James Butts' gigantic ego. He also had to have illegal advertising in the form of dozens, if not hundreds, of signs illegally placed on public land and abandoned properties. They were in bushes. They were on parkways. They were in bushes on parkways. Just about everywhere they weren't supposed to be. In fact, along with his political ally Gloria Gray, James Butts put his signs in some of the most illegal places possible. Butts' illegal signs were not just on parkways and in bushes, but on bus stops, and not only next to power boxes, but on power boxes. Inglewood's municipal code says that it's illegal to put any signs on any public land or on any objects on that public land, and the code that talks about political signs doesn't say that they can be put anywhere that regular signs can't be put. It was bad enough when Gloria Gray had a sign on library property, but James Butts actually had a sign of his on police department property. Things got so bad, I finally called code enforcement, and they said the signs weren't supposed to be there. They even told me that I could take the signs out myself, but I let them do their job. And here we see a code enforcement officer taking down a Darius Levy sign and a James Butts sign, as they did with dozens of signs around the city after I called, including this one that's right at the end of Butts' own street. Now, some people might try to make excuses for the mayor, saying that it was people who worked for him who put up the signs, and that the mayor might not have even known that the signs were placed illegally. But the problem with that is that the mayor claims that he lives right here, at 2512 West 102nd Street. So not only is it almost impossible that James Butts wouldn't have seen all the dozens of illegally placed signs with his name on them as he was driving around Inglewood, but when he left his house in the morning and drove only about 4 short blocks to Century Boulevard to go to City Hall, and when he came home at night, it would have been impossible for him not to see the illegally placed sign that was right here. The illegally placed sign that wasn't just illegally placed because I say so, but because code enforcement said so and came out and took it down. But let's say that Butts went the long way to get to Century or Manchester Boulevards. Even then, driving 7 short blocks and making a right turn on Crenshaw Boulevard, he still couldn't have missed several of his illegally placed signs, right next to his partner in crime, Gloria Gray. And for those of you who still don't believe that James Butts would break the law, we offer you these additional facts. People who go to Inglewood City Council meetings know that although he lied and repeatedly tried to deny it, when James Butts was police chief in Santa Monica, he was personally sued for approving a policy where his officers systematically violated people's civil rights. He asked the court to give him immunity from being sued because he was a police officer, but the court said that what he and his officers did were so bad, so illegal, that they probably knew what they were doing was illegal, so they would have to stand trial. Then, in the landmark civil rights case Butts versus McNally, Butts and the other defendants appealed the court's decision and lost twice. Then Butts asked the United States Supreme Court to look at the case, and his request was denied again. First, just so we all know what we're talking about, the Miranda rules are what help guarantee every American their constitutional right against self-incrimination. If arrested, the police must tell you that you have the right to remain silent and have the right to speak to an attorney and have an attorney present when you are being questioned, because it is a documented fact that police frequently intimidate people into saying things that aren't true. The courts have also ruled that if a citizen indicates in any manner that they want to remain silent and wait for an attorney, the police must end the questioning. Now, some people don't like that, but usually that's because they falsely assume that if someone's being interrogated, they must be guilty, which is not only un-American, but false. It is also unfortunate that this incorrect assumption is bolstered by the fact that many cases like Butts versus McNally that established case law involved people who had actually committed the crime that they were accused of. But that's because when people's civil rights are violated by the police and they are not guilty of the crime, the police usually let them go home, and the victims of the civil rights violations do nothing, even though the police did violate the law, because the victims are so happy to have been set free and they really didn't have the money to sue the police anyway. So the civil rights cases that make it to the high courts frequently involve victims of civil rights abuses who have to go to court because they are looking at serious penalties, even death, for the crimes they are accused of. And those are the types of high-profile cases that attorneys and civil rights organizations take on for free. But the important thing to remember is that if a police department has a policy of violating civil rights, they do it with everyone, even the innocent. For instance, even before the Butts case, an innocent man, Michael Cooper, was wrongly accused of rape, and the police violated his Miranda rights the same way Butts officers were trained to do. Eventually, the police admitted they were wrong, but the man sued, and the court ruled at that time that once someone indicates that they want to speak to an attorney, the interrogation must end. But after that, Butts still approved his officers doing the same thing that the court said was illegal. But even though what Butts did was undeniable, he still tried to deny it.
Deputy District Attorney Orange County named Devalis Rutledge, and he wrote a training memo about questioning outside of Miranda. And what he recommended was that when a suspect invoked, that even though his statements could not be used against him, to continue to question anyway, because if the suspect took the stand, then his statements now could be used to impeach him, and that was the quality of the law then. He published a training bulletin, he sent it to Santa Monica, my training officer sent it out.
So the first time Butts lied about his crime, he completely left out the part where he approved the policy. He just said that a training bulletin was published, it was sent to Santa Monica, and his training officer sent it out. And Butts kept lying.
Now, when they sue the police department, they sue the chief. And here I go, I get subpoenaed to federal court. I have nothing to do with it, but I'm the chief.
So James Butts not only misled the public by leaving out the part where he actually approved the policy, but then he lies and said that he had nothing to do with the crime. And James Butts outright lied at another meeting.
Mrs. Brown continually says that I was found guilty of violating Miranda. Well, actually, there was a lawsuit against some detectives that worked for me. That did something called questioning outside Miranda. And because I was the chief, I was sued.
James Butts lied, trying to fool the public into thinking that he was sued as a formality just because he was police chief. But that's not what happened. These court documents prove that Butts was lying. He was sued in his official capacity as police chief, but he was also specifically sued as an individual. These court documents prove that Butts was personally sued because he personally approved his department's policy of violating the Miranda rules, even though there had already been a court ruling establishing that the policy was illegal. And the documents show that Butts failed to rescind his department's illegal policy even after the court had established that what he was doing was illegal. And on still another night, James Butts again tried to pretend like he was sued as a formality, that he had nothing to do with what happened.
And the ACLU took that up, and the court said, oh, they shouldn't have done that, and they held me responsible because I'm the chief.
James Butts lies again, stating that the court only said that his officers shouldn't have broken the law, and that the court only held Butts responsible because he was the chief, when the fact is that the court ruled that all the Santa Monica defendants, including Butts, had to stand trial because they were all responsible for the violations of the law. But James Butts kept lying, trying to deny his involvement.
Said, oh, they shouldn't have done that, and they held me responsible because I'm the chief. We didn't tell anybody to do it.
One of the most prestigious law journals in the world proves that Butts did tell his officers to do it, stating, quote, the defendant police departments and officers conceded the existence of both the training materials and the policy of deliberately violating the Miranda rules. Even this police officer association states about the case that, quote, the individual officers are not helped by the fact that they were simply following the training that they had been given. And when Butts came to Inglewood, he admitted that he'd approved that training.
Now, in 1993, I signed a training bulletin that was put out by a guy named Devalis Rutledge from Orange County. He was a district attorney, deputy district attorney, and he did training, and it talked about questioning outside of Miranda.
So Butts admits he approved officers being trained to violate Miranda rights, but then he says,
we didn't tell anybody to do it. But
wait a minute, James. Didn't you say,
I signed a training bulletin.
Then how can you say,
we didn't tell anybody to do it.
So James Butts admits that as Santa Monica's police chief, he personally signed and approved his officers' training to violate people's Miranda rights. But then he says that nobody told his officers to violate people's Miranda rights. But that's James Butts for you. He lies. But James Butts' deliberate violation of the law and the Constitution didn't end when he left Santa Monica. When the carpet-bagging Butts returned to Inglewood to run for mayor and becoming mayor, he misled, lied, broke the law, and violated civil rights as much or more than when he was in Santa Monica. Butts' deliberate violation of the law and civil rights got so bad that the Los Angeles County DA was asked to investigate, and the DA's Bureau of Fraud and Corruption Prosecutions found that Butts had repeatedly violated both state law and free speech rights as mayor. So considering the court found that James Butts helped train his officers to violate the law and civil rights when he was Santa Monica's police chief, and considering the L.A. County DA found that Butts personally violated the law and civil rights as Inglewood's mayor, Considering all that, it isn't surprising that James Butts would also violate city ordinances and campaign rules when he ran for mayor. It isn't surprising, but it's still very disappointing.